just come in time.
We are continuing the ongoing saga of the three toads who are sitting on three toadstools.
We are now at the highlight of the story, and we join them now as they are just talking about living above ground.
I'm glad I'm not a mole.
From the streets, oh, how he would lose.
person here tonight, a special warm welcome to you. Tonight we're exploring the topic of living above ground. And you're probably saying, well, I live above ground, unless you're a worm. But what we're looking at is, what we're exploring is living above the expectations of society. So we're going to project that through the mediums of dance, drama and song. And first up, we're going to start with a congregational song. It's your opportunity to get involved, stand up and sing it if you wish. And the team are going to come on right now, so please, as they come on, stand up and give them a warm welcome.
A lot of empty land around the building. That is because we are putting on an extension. We've managed to get the houses moved from next door and opposite the car park during the week, so we are all go on that. So that's going to happen very shortly. Bits and pieces as you come along, you'll see a noticeable change. Before the end of the year, we will be celebrating in a new building.
Amen.
So just please be careful out there. You can't go all the way around the building anymore because you all get covered in mud if you try and go out this door and round to the street. I suggest you find the exit down here. Okay, the next special event that we have is next week, 10:30 live, right here, and it's called The Body Perfect. I was looking at this before and it reminded me of Derek and his supernatural man. But right here, The Body Perfect, looking good, feeling good. Okay? To help you with that, there are some flyers that are available out in the foyer. If you'd like to grab one, please do so. After the service this evening, we have a cup of tea, which is available for you out in the foyer out here. The guys will be serving that. So if you have any questions after tonight's service, please find somebody who brought you, or just somebody who you recognise, and go up to them and just ask a question. They'll be more than happy to point you in the right direction or answer them themselves. Okay. Right now we have the drama team, and then we'll have a dance. So let's have a round of applause for them.
Soon.
Yes.
Here.
did we pay for this?
Three for a dollar.
Right. Do you know how much the shops actually pay for one of these? 7 cents each.
Thanks. I'm starving.
That was good.
That's a laugh. They only employ school kids so they can get away with paying minimum wage. The shop is not going to miss 25 cents.
Yeah, but that's not the point. What would you have done if they had overcharged you?
Got my money back.
Exactly. So don't you think when it's round the other way, we should try to be fair and square things up?
No. Such a big thing about this for. It's not like everyone else is going to rush back to the shop and give back money that isn't theirs.
Oh, and just because everyone else does it makes it right?
Maybe not right, but acceptable.
Oh, does it turn double standards mean anything?
Oh, little Miss Righteous!
Oh, just say it!
What the heck is all this shouting about?
We're not shouting! But it's the Moral and Ethics Commissioner here. Her and her 25 cents. The very 25 cents that's going to lead to the moral decay of our society and our civilization as we know it!
I am not trying to save the world! It's just the principle of the thing!
What
kind of this
is it?
The storm undercharged me 25 cents.
We'll go back to the shop and give them their money.
It's only 25 cents. It's
no! Do what you know you have to do.
Bye.
Thank you. Oh, know every one of us. Has a choice to live above ground. Years ago, I remember, at work, the guys used to have this question. They used to come and ask us when we'd been married a while. They used to ask the question, they used to say to us something like this: when was the last time you beat your wife? Most of us weren't quick enough to realise that it didn't matter which way we answered the particular question, if we didn't think hard enough, we were in trouble. Guys would then point the finger and say, "Ha, I knew you did it." Today it's shifted slightly. They don't ask the question, everybody just assumes that everybody's cheating on their wives or husbands, girlfriends or boyfriends or lovers. Doesn't matter who. It's still this build-up within our lives, which sort of happens. In the end, people often buy into this kind of thinking. And they'll say things like, "It's normal, isn't it? It's just normal to be having these things happen in your life." And continually we face this kind of drip feed that's called normal. And yet most of us know that life is really not simple like that. It's a complex set of values, expectations, highs, lows, troubles, dangers, pain, suffering, loves, and sometimes joys that are so great that they leave us feeling so full of expectation that we feel like at some point we're going to burst with what's happening. This is life. This is life, and they are all parts of life. And sometimes we know it has to be changed, but we're not quite sure how we can do it, and we're not always aware of the fact that slowly but surely there's a build-up of problems happening in our lives. There's things that are happening to us. Everybody else can see it, but sometimes we just live as if nothing is happening. So I want you to take yourself for a moment and imagine, put yourself in your most wildest of dreams. Imagine you're the perfect person, that you really do have it together, that everything you do is ideal, and other people look at you and they say, "There is that man, or there is that woman that you know about." And everybody knows who you're talking of. I mean, I only need to mention the name Teresa. And if you're thinking of somebody with high honour and all the rest of it, you don't think of people living in Porirua. Many people think of Mother Teresa, as she's called. I don't like the term mother, but never mind. But she certainly had a profound effect on others, and she lived way beyond the norm. She lived way beyond the potential that might have been imagined. Or take Martin Luther King. Martin Luther King, a guy who really did struggle with issues in his own life, but somehow was willing to lay his life on the line, and he changed everything. He changed the whole of America, and as a consequence, changed the face of the world, and as a consequence of that, changed Africa and many other people's worldviews. Because he lived beyond what might be seeming to be the norm. Everyone held them in awe, except for perhaps some of those who knew them really closely, like they know you and I. You see, for most of us, that's not really the reality that we live in. Do you remember at the beginning of June this year, there was this report, I can't remember where it was overseas somewhere, there were thousands of dollars dropped out of a security truck. Now, can you imagine, how on earth could you drop thousands of dollars out of a security truck? The door can't have been closed. That doesn't say much for security, does it? And everybody It was on the news, you know, all this money being dropped, and everybody goes, oh yeah, I bet you somebody got it. All of us, I think, or most of us perhaps. Some might have been generous in spirit, but a lot of us probably thought things like, I wonder where I went, I wonder who got it, I wonder who took it. Those guys will never see it again. But you see, it didn't happen like that. Somebody found it. Well, we all knew that was going to happen. But what we didn't expect was that that somebody took it and handed it in. Now, I sat there and I imagined myself, and it was a bundle. Remember the bundle that was shown on TV about this size? All nights. Lots of money. And I can imagine finding that, and I can imagine what I would have gone through. And you might say to me, well, you're a pastor, you'd do better than us. No, I wouldn't. I would have looked at it and I would have thought, man, that would be nice in my pocket, but the trouble is at that size, it wouldn't have fitted in my pocket. I would have said, well, this would solve a few problems for a few years. I could pay for the church, new church auditorium, and we could pay for this, and we could pay for that. And I could probably buy myself a couple of nice trips around the world, and there was a lot of money there. You know, every one of us would have been tempted to do that. Every one of us would have been thinking, I've got it! Money! But the trouble is, every one of us would have, if we'd kept it or tried to keep it, struggled. And I've always wondered, I'd love to go and ask the person who handed it in, did you want to keep it? And did you actually initially keep it and then feel so guilty about it that you knew you had to take it back? Because something went on in that person's life. They didn't just find a packet and say, oh, it's a money, I better go and hand it in. Didn't happen like that. It never happens like that for any of us. You see, they went through this massive struggle. I want you to imagine that person. Finders keepers, goes the rule of society. But it's not the truth. But we all buy it. I remember finding some money some years ago when I was a little boy. In Chevy, the small town we lived in, there was this little corner, two streets met on a funny angle like this. And there was a park, a little small park with a little bench in it, a little park bench. And what actually happened on this park bench, I used to go to the park bench after school. This little park was a nice little park. It was the only little park in Cheviot. I mean, if you blink, you go through Cheviot in any case. So it was there. Very small park. And I found this money. And I took it over to Mum and Dad and I said, look what I found. And it was a 10 shilling note and some coin. Now, 10 shillings was a lot of money in those days. Well, I got told that I'd stolen it, first of all. So in any case, they took it to the policeman, and the policeman had a talk with me about stealing and where did I steal it from, and they asked the school if they were missing money and things that had happened. I felt kind of bad, but I found this money. Well, a few days later, I went back to the park bench. See, boys are curious like that sometimes. I went back to see if there's some more. Now, I should have stayed away, because when I got there, here was this money sitting under the park bench. I picked it up and I thought, well, this time, they will know I never stole it. They will know I found it. So I went home, told them I found some money. Guess what? They weren't overjoyed. Took me along to talk to the policeman again. Well, the policeman was an awesome, fearsome figure in our community. He had a great authority, and I was terrified of the guy, and I tried to tell him I'd found the money. Well, somewhere in the policeman's mind, something must have happened, because for the next few nights, apparently, and I only found this out a few weeks later, he went along to this park bench, and lo and behold, what happened? He found some money. Now, nobody thought to accuse the policeman of stealing the money. They just accepted he found it. You see, he was living, in the eyes of society, above me. And I hadn't found the money. I'd stolen it, even though I had found it. The thing was that what happened, I was exonerated. I was told, well, you're a good boy, coming and handing the money in, said the policeman. And I felt good. I felt I'd risen above what I had been. You see, the pleasure was all mine at that point. You see, we often miss out on reaching our potential because we bypass the obvious. In the old days, there's a story. In ancient times, the king, he got a boulder. And he put it in the middle of the road. and his courtiers and some of his other wealthy people in his land, they all came past the boulder on the road and they looked at the boulder and some of them thought, the king doesn't look after his road very well. I don't want to pay my taxes. This is the way things are going to be. And they walked around the boulder. So the king was hiding behind the building on the side of the road. He was looking at this boulder, watching the boulder. Eventually a peasant came along with a big armload of vegetables, trying to make a living, struggling to make a living. The peasant arrived, saw the boulder on the road, and he thought, I wonder what this boulder's doing here. The poor king, somebody's left a boulder on his road. So after much struggling, he put down his vegetables. He went over to the boulder, and with great effort and struggle, he managed to move it off the road. And it was a hard thing for this peasant, because he hadn't been well fed, and life had been pretty tough. So he got the boulder to the side of the road, and the king smiled with pleasure. And then as the peasant bent down to pick up his vegetables, he noticed on the road a little bag. He went over and he picked the bag up and he opened it up, and inside the bag was a note with a whole lot of money. It was from the king. And it said this. It said that the gold is through the person who removed the boulder from the roadway. The peasant learned what many others never understood. Every obstacle presents an opportunity if we only look for it. And today you've taken the opportunity to come here to look for it. So in dealing with obstacles, the things that would stop us from reaching our potential, we need to think about what they are. What are the things that particularly apply to you or to I here in this room? What kinds of things stop us getting the reward of living above the expectations of others? I want to suggest just four things, briefly. First of all, religious stuff. Secondly, moral stuff. Thirdly, our own hurt and pain for whatever reasons. And fourthly, negative or destructive attitudes. You see, the question, what will you do with your pile of expectations? Every little bit is not helpful. What will you do? Because there's going to be plenty of them who are going to load it on you. There's going to be plenty of them who are going to come and they're going to bring them and they're going to say, this is you. This is you. This is your dirt. And sure, it may have been true, but it's not necessarily true. And I think every one of us wants to take the right to tell them, you come here, and you come here, and you come here, and you take this stuff away. I don't want it anymore. Shall we tell them?
Yeah.
Yeah, let's say, yeah!
Yeah!
You see, none of us want this kind of stuff in reality. But most of us accept it. Some of us we contribute to it ourselves. But at the end of the day, we don't want it, and we can tell it to go today.
And it went.
And it went. And I want to say this today. There are three things I believe to be true. First of all, the first one is this. We are capable of greater things. Greater than what we already achieve. I don't care how high an achiever you are, how great you are, we're still capable of greater. Two, it is possible for each one of us to be great. It's not that we're going to be famous, but we're going to be great in the sense of the fact that we will go beyond where we are. We have a potential which is great. And the third one, reaching your potential will bring pleasure to you and to God. The first thing, the first one, it is possible for, we are capable of greater things, greater than what we achieve. There's an old Arabian proverb that goes like this, four things come not back, the spoken word, the sped arrow, the past life we've lived, and the neglected opportunity. There are four things that come not back. Once they've gone, they're gone. They're spent. They're done. So if we think about that, we'll realise that there's something we need to do to change it. There's a man, his name was Jerry. He was a guy who worked as a restaurant manager. Everywhere that Jerry went, he had such an amazing influence on his staff that if he moved to another restaurant, his staff would actually follow him. And so Jerry, when he moved, would end up with these staff traipsing after him. When Jerry was having a bad day, he was always telling people the positive things about the day. When others were having a rough time, Jerry would always inject a positive aspect into their lives. He would always be telling them how to look on the positive side of the situation. Seeing the style, a friend of his one day went up to Jerry and asked him, "I don't get it. You can't be a positive person all of the time. How do you do it?" And Jerry replied, "Each morning I wake up and I say to myself, Jerry, you have two choices today. You can choose to be in a good mood or you can choose to be in a bad mood. I choose to be in a good mood. Each time something bad happens, I can choose to be a victim or I can choose to learn from it. I choose to learn from it. Every time someone comes to me complaining, I can choose to accept their complaining or I can point out the positive side of life. I choose the positive side of life. Yeah, right. It's not that way, that easy," I protested. "Yes," as Jerry said, "life is all about choices. When you cut away all the junk, every situation is a choice." Several years later, his friend left the restaurant business and went elsewhere. And one day he heard a story about Jerry. He made a serious mistake and the fact that he was working in the restaurant and he left the back door open. And as he was working in the restaurant, managing the restaurant, two guys came in. They told him to open the safe. They wanted to rob the restaurant. You see, one of the restaurant's rules is that you should never leave the back door open. So what actually happened is, he was trying to undo the safe, he was so nervous he was shaking. And he slipped. And one of the robbers took it that he was about to do something, so they shot him. And Jerry lay in a pool of blood on the ground. The robbers, out of fright, took off and ran away. Unfortunately, somebody came and they managed to call the paramedics. Well, as they took him to intensive care, the paramedics and the ambulance were saying to him, "It's all right, man, hang on, you're going to live, you're going to be all right, you're going to be all right." And Jerry's laying there thinking, "I'm going to die. No, no, no. I've got two choices here. I can die or I can live." So he was laying there thinking, "I'm going to live. These guys told me, I'm going to live, I'm going to live." So he's laying there in the hospital, and in the ambulance rather, and they woke at the hospital, and as they got into the emergency room, this paramedic saying, "Hang on, man, you're going to make it, you're going to make it." So he was hanging on. When the doctors looked down at him, he could see in the eyes, "Man, he's a dead man." He could see it. Starkly staring at it, at his eyes. You know, he said, "I got really scared looking into their eyes. I read, he's a dead man." He said, "I knew I needed to take action." "What did you do?" asked his friend. there I was. And there was a big burly nurse shouting questions at me, said Jerry. She asked if I was allergic to anything. Yes, I replied. The doctors and nurses still stopped working on me. And they waited for my reply. And I took a deep breath as I struggled to speak. And I yelled, "Bullets!"
Yeah, bullets.
Over their laughter, I told them, "I'm choosing to live. Operate on me as if I am alive, not dead." Jerry lived thanks to the skill of his doctors, but also because of his amazing attitude. I learned from him that very day, we have the choice to live fully. Attitude, after all, is everything, in a sense. Now, every one of us here in this room can choose to live a life with high potential, or we can choose to die a life which is frustrating to us. It's the way it is, just like with Jerry. The second thing is, it is possible for every one of us to be great. Jesus had these words to say. He says, "I tell you the truth, anyone who has faith in me will do what I have been doing. He will do even greater things than these, because I am going to the Father, and will do whatever you ask in my name, so that the Son may bring glory to the Father. You may ask me for anything in my name, and I will do it." Now, did you hear what he said? We all know, probably, and if you don't, you'd be well advised to ask some questions. Jesus was probably one of the most amazing people in history. In fact, he was. He had high respect even of his enemies. They were scared of his power because he had so much faith that he could heal and raise the dead. And it wasn't something that happened now and again like it's happened for us. It's something that was normal. He lived a life of potential that was way above anybody else in his time and anybody else in history since, or anybody else before. He had the ability to teach society lessons that no other man had ever taught. He had the ability to even die with grace at the hands of others. Great man and great God. And every one of us can live to that potential. He said we can do greater things. Trouble is, most of us don't even think we could even accept the concept. If we're really honest, some of us would want to probably say, "Well, I'm not sure that he really said that. How can I be certain he said that?" Just think about who he is, and you would realize. And we as people, we can be divided into three groups. Those who make things happen, those who watch things happen, and those who wonder what happened. Most of us either wonder or watch. We're limited by all sorts of things. Attitudes, history, things we've experienced. And some of us even limited by things we don't understand, including sometimes spiritual activity that is really destructive. Some years ago we had a lady come into this church. We've had many people with similar experiences, but this lady came to the church and she lived near here, and one of the first things that happened for her was she said to me, "Gary, I've got these things at home called rune stones. I think I need to get rid of them because they're a spiritual thing and I think they're bad." She got rid of them. That lady's sitting in this auditorium here tonight, a woman who is changing, a woman whose potential is just starting to be reached. But while those other things were there in her life, there was no hope of that happening. See, I know what it's like. Before I became a Christian, I was definitely an underachiever. When I first became became a Christian, I started achieving at a greater level, but I had no idea what God could do in my life. I want to say right now that I still haven't reached the full potential that God's got for me. I'm on the journey. But boy, it's an exciting journey, and it's way beyond the kind of piles of dirt. You see, the earth's been removed. It's been taken away. I don't have to believe it anymore. I don't have to live with it anymore. It might have been me in the past, but no longer does it exist for me. We can, we are able to live way above what we are. And the third one is that we can be reaching our potential and bringing pleasure to ourselves and to God. There's a guy called Elmer Homenberger. Not sure I pronounced his name exactly right, but we'll take it as that. He said this: we do not get faith by arguing about religion. That's most people think, you know, if you argue about things, you try and sort all out your heads, you're going to get faith. He says we get faith on our knees. In and through surrender and prayer, God gives faith to those who need and want it. Now, if you listen to this and connect it with what Jesus said, you will see there's some sense in it. See, Jesus said we will do greater things. But we've got to acknowledge you can't just do great things unless you have a relationship with the one who gives you the potential to do so. See, God didn't just set us up like a bunch of clockwork clocks, wind us up. I used to have one of these clockwork toys, you know? Used to wind up in the back and just go along this. You know the things? You remember them? Sometimes we tend to treat God as if that's what we like. You see, we're quite different to that, aren't we, really? You see, what he said to us, I've set you on earth, I'll give you certain abilities, I'll give you certain capabilities. There's only one way that this thing here is going to work, is if it's plugged in. You have it unplugged. You take the power source off, and that thing's in trouble. And I want to tell you now, that thing will do a certain amount of stuff without the power on it, but there's something it can't do. It can't play good music. It can only look like it's going to, and it can do a certain amount of stuff, but it can't do everything. And you see, the connection that we can have with God is very real. In the book of Ecclesiastes, the reading was taken from today. It was some wise words. It says this: a man can do nothing better than to eat and drink and find satisfaction in his work. This too, I see, is from the hand of God, for without him, who can eat or find enjoyment? To the man who pleases him, God gives wisdom, knowledge, and happiness. But to the sinner, in other words, the person who doesn't want to associate with God, he gives the task of gathering and storing up wealth to hand it over to the one who does please God. This too is meaningless, a chasing after the wind. And then this is the next passage of the piece that probably most of you have heard. There is a season. There is a time for everything, and a season for every activity under heaven. A time to be born and a time to die. Now it talks about a time to dance, a time to love. It talks about all these different times. The seasons are there. But what if we live in the cave of our own isolation? We might miss out. And I believe the three things that are mentioned in that passage that we read are clear. None of us of ourselves have wisdom on our own. We need the wisdom of God. None of us has real knowledge except for the knowledge of God. I remember a guy called William Carver, an old Negro man, or young Negro man he was, when this story happened. He said to God after he got his degree, he's one of the early Negroes to get a degree in the universities, he said, God, I've only got a small mind. He said, God, I need something that's about the size of my mind to work with. You show me everything. You reveal to me, because you're the God of knowledge, everything about it. And he felt to look at the peanut. He felt that was a good representation of the size of his mind. And this is a bright man. This is a man who got his degree against all odds in a society where Negroes were persecuted. He studied the small peanut. He studied it. You know what he found in it? 53 different oils in one peanut. What do you reckon? Where did the knowledge come from? How did it happen? He had a relationship with God. But the last one, I believe, is one of the things that we search for so much in our society and we very rarely ever capture. Happiness. A solid, healthy relationship with God will be the thing that will take us beyond the potential of others. We will live above ground. And I want to say tonight, God has made us with three aspects to our life. The first one there we see is passion. The second one we see is personality. The third one is spiritual gifts. Now, I want you to grab hold of this. You may never have seen this kind of concept before, but most of us know about this and we know about passion. But most of us don't always know about this, and this includes people who are Christians. Maybe intellectually they know, but in practice, it lacks. And when you hear the words of Jesus, you have to realize that part of what he was saying was tied up with this deal here, because of the things that he actually did in his own life. You see, it's no good us being spiritual . We have to be real. When God calls us and he asks us to live above the potential that society would put on us, the expectations that society would put on us, and live in the potential that he's designed for us, we have to realize that he knows what he's talking about. We need to realize that it goes beyond our own situation. See, the passion has to do with the heart. And God constantly and consistently says to us as humans, very clearly, I love you. And I believe part of the release of our potential has to do with the release of a potential to love. Not just in a general sense, but to love God and to really love others around us. But the only way we're going to do that is if we can also learn to love ourselves enough. Jesus made those things very clear. You see, at the end of the day, the thing that we need to realize, that Jesus said this very clearly to us all. You can be greater. You can be greater. Greater things will you be able to do. My invitation to you tonight, and our invitation to you tonight, is that in thinking, think about yourself. Whether you claim to be a Christian or not is not the issue. It's whether you're doing the things that God would love to have for you. Whether you're experiencing the potential and the dynamics of life that would leave you feeling as if you're like Jerry. Everything can be changed. You have a choice, two choices. This way or that. I'm going to ask you tonight, what are you going to choose? I had a friend who was a Christian just within the last 2 days. He said to me, Gary, I know that I really messed up. But I want to go forward, and I sometimes feel as if other people look at me and they don't let me do it. I have a choice at that point, is my answer. To accept what I think other people are saying, which often isn't what they're saying, but it's sometimes what we suspect they're saying. and we're deceived by some of the things we think. Or I can choose to ignore those things and say, I'm going to be great. I'm going to live above the potential that I've been experiencing. And I'm going to know God, and I'm going to know His power and His strength. I'm going to know what He can do in my life. And I reckon that's worth doing. So tonight what we're going to do right now is I'm going to pray a prayer that if you would like to join with me in, I'd love to invite you to feel that freedom to do so. I want to say to you that already by stepping out and coming here tonight, that you've stepped beyond the potential of many in society. Because a lot of people are chicken. They say that people are Christians are weaklings, but they just conform to the rest of society, and it takes some courage to go beyond that and to be a Christian. So I'm going to pray right now. And it's a challenge for us to pray the kind of prayer I'm going to pray. But if you do agree with it, I'd like you at the end of it, when I say, and all the people say, you can say amen, because it means I agree. Or you can call out I agree if you like. I don't care. As long as your heart is saying that. So I'm going to do that right now. God, tonight we come to you because we recognize that you have designed us to go beyond the potential we've experienced. For some of us here, we're struggling with really believing that you can do that. For some of us, we're struggling with ourselves to believe that we'd be even willing to let you do that. And for some of us here, we have failed to let you do it in the past, and we've said we will let you do it, but we haven't really come to that place. And we simply want to say to you tonight, Lord, forgive us for the wrong we've done in ignoring you and not doing what you want us to do. Forgive us for the times when we've actually done the exact opposite. When we have done wrong, when we have done what is called sin. We have sinned in your eyes, we have done wrong in your eyes. So we ask that you would touch our lives. Jesus, we want to believe what you've said, and so we ask you to help us to know you and walk with you and to be able to do the things you said that we could do. We're on a bit of a journey, Lord, and we need your help. So help us, we pray, in Jesus' name. And all the people said,
Amen.